I think the question is agreed by majority, respectively, of each of the two groups of members. I declare the motion passed. Debate on motions with no legislative effect, ensuring occupational safety. Members who wish to speak in the motion will please press the request to speak button, and I'll call upon Mr. Poon Siu-ping to speak and move the motion. Mr. Poon Siu-ping, President, I move that the motion be, as printed on the agenda, be passed. Early last year, I also moved a motion on ensuring occupational safety, and this year I am raising a motion on a similar subject. And some colleagues asked me, you have raised this before, why you are raising this again this year? Well, the reasons are simple. After I moved the motion last year, the number of industrial accidents has not decreased. In 2013, there were 22 fatal accidents in the construction industry. And up to this year, up to October, the fatal accidents in construction industry totaled 18 already. When the government is pressing ahead with major infrastructure projects, I'm very concerned about the workers' safety. Early this year, the Development Bureau Director, Secretary, in response to a question raised at the meeting, said that following the works commencement of infrastructure projects, the public expenditure has risen from $45.3 billion from 2009 to over $70 billion up to last year. While in the next few years, the infrastructure projects expenditure will be more or less at the $70 million level. According to CIC's industries, the construction and the expenditure on construction projects has increased from $129 billion 10 years ago to $200 billion this year. So the construction industry has been booming, and the wages in the construction industries have moved upwards. There are reports saying that there will be an increase of 9.5% of construction workers' wages. And for some specific trades, it can be as high as 15%. So for the workers, if their salaries can be increased and their lives improved, and they're very happy. But then at the same time, they have worries. There are reports saying that the construction projects, a certain size, sort of around the clock, and to get a better income, some construction workers work 15 hours a day from 7 a.m. to 12 midnight, and they are treating the construction sites as their homes. So we're in a dilemma. Well, we understand why workers want to work harder. The construction industry has a lot of fluctuation, so to speak, and construction workers have to work when there are works projects, and they work from morning till night, and their health is jeopardized. And their risk of accidents also increases. In the next few years, there will be a large number of infrastructure projects going on at the same time, and that doesn't do any good to workers' health. And actually, the effect is already beginning to be felt. Earlier, there are many MTRCL projects going on at the same time, and there has been a slippage of the project schedule, and the commencement or commissioning of railway projects time has been affected. Now, in order to catch up for the shortfall or the lacking in the times, the timetable, well, the MTRCL will be asking construction workers to work extra hard from morning till night, and then there will be a higher risk of industrial accidents. For the government, well, the infrastructure projects can sort of balance the construction workload. Now, if there are more private construction projects, the government can adjust its public works workload so that there will be sort of the work volume can be balanced out. Now, at the same time, if there are fewer private construction projects, the government can launch more public works projects to make up for the shortfall in the construction volume. So that that if we have a stable workload, then that would do every good to the construction sector and the health of the workers. In the past, the CE and also the relevant government officials, when they speak about an increase in the infrastructure works expenditure, they feel very proud. And we need to press ahead with our infrastructure projects to maintain Hong Kong's competitiveness. But at the same time, should we be reviewing the priorities so that not all infrastructure work projects will be carried out at the same time? And then the workers don't have to work from morning till night just to get more income when there are works around. And this will do no good to workers' safety. So this is a policy matter, and I hope that the government consider this. Now, on the 19th of last month, at the construction worker site at the Hong Kong Zhuhao Macau Bridge, there was an accident causing one fatality and four people got injured. And this is a third fatal accident related to the project. And in October, when a worker was trying to carry the pipeline to the project site, and he died because his glove was sort of trapped by the pipes. And then another worker fell into the sea when dealing with the sludge, and he died, passed away. And in December 2012, there were serious industrial accidents, and the work platforms collapsed, and one person died and 14 got injured. Well, for the project, four workers died in total. Last week, the government responded to a question on industrial accidents of the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge. And the government said that from 2012 up to the first half of this year, there were just two fatalities. Well, this is not the fact. And earlier this month, there were media reports saying that there was overspending and a project delay of the project. And I am worried that in order to compress expenditure and to speed up the work, there will even be more accidents related to the project. So in future projects, the government must implement effective measures to prevent serious industrial accidents at the project. Well, the statistics for the first half of this year is this. Fatal industrial accidents, total 15, compared to the first half of 2013, a rise of 200%. The Secretary for Health and Welfare, responding to my motion last year, said that the Labour Department and the stakeholders of the construction industry have been working together to launch measures to enhance safety in phases, and those include try to prevent systemic risks in the industry, and they would also be focusing on high-risk sectors and adopt targeted approach in dealing with the problems. But then in the past few years, the number of industrial accidents has not been cut. It means that the measures have not been effective. At present, the CIC or SHC is responsible for promoting occupational safety, but for the execution work that has been done by an LD, including monitoring work safety, taking out prosecutions, and I think there is a need to review that such division of work. The construction industry is a high-risk sector, and catering industry also is another high-risk sector. There are over 250,000 workers in the catering industry. There were over 5,740 accidents in the industry, 25 in every 1,000 workers. And there were burns and falling on the slips and so on. And they took up 60% of all industrial accidents. And in a survey conducted by OSHC, of around 50% of the burned workers, well, in that workplace, there were no notices alerting workers of such risk, and 30% of those which were hurt by staves were said that there were pressing work tasks. And for those 70% who suffered from slips said that there were no anti-slip measures implemented at the workplace. Well, these are not problems which are difficult to overcome. If we can implement effective measures, then workers' safety can be improved. We must also talk about lower limb diseases or disorders. Well, the lower limb disorders are not compensable diseases as of today. In the catering industries, there are 250,000 workers, making up 16.8% of all workers in Hong Kong. It employs the largest number of workers. But then frontline workers in that industry, because they have to stand a long time, they have are suffering or developing lower limb diseases or disorders, and these are not considered or categorized as occupational diseases. So I urge the administration to include these as occupational diseases. The CE in his election manifesto promised that a dedicated committee will be set up comprising employers and employees' representatives and also the Labour Department representatives to improve occupational safety and health, including insurance, compensation therapy, and rehabilitation. So I hope that the CE can deliver his promise and set up the dedicated committee as soon as possible. And I hope this committee can comprehensively review the policies in Hong Kong employees' occupational safety and health and reduce the number of industrial accidents so that workers can truly be protected in terms of occupational safety. So I hope that members can support my motion. I now propose the question to you, and that is that the motion moved by Mr. Poon Siu-ping be passed. Two members will move amendments to this motion. This council will now proceed to a joint debate on the motion and the two amendments. I will first call upon the Honourable Tang Ka-piu to speak, to be followed by the Honourable Chan Kin-por, but they may not move amendments at this stage. Honourable Tang Ka-piu.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy. We work for employees' rights, and what upsets us most are industrial accidents ending in injuries or even fatality, because a loss of life will shatter and break up families, especially, say, families of drivers or workers. They are grassroots, and if the sole breadwinner is lost, then it will be a huge blow to the family. And the number of accidents is more or less the same as last year. And this, with this motion being proposed this year again, it shows that we are very concerned about this. We are concerned, and it's also written in the CY Leung's manifesto. However, there is little improvement that we have seen. And from the figures, it seems that the situation has worsened. And sometimes we wonder how many accidents and fatalities happen a year. And we will first start with the factories operation ordinance, and we use the figures there. But on a wider scope, we need something that will reflect the general situation in Hong Kong, including clerical staff as well. Then you will have to use the number of cases submitted under the ECO, Employment and Compensation Ordinance. For the first half of 2013, there are 83 cases with fatalities. And what about in 2014? For the first half, 102 cases. It's a marked increase and a deterioration, obviously. So in the past year, the administration or the secretary, have they done anything, legislative amendments, education, publicity, to improve the work environment of employees? One main concern is long working hours. And Mr. Poon talked about long working hours and poor work environments ending in a lot of injuries. We see that long working hours is a potential risk, because if you work long hours, then you'll be tired, then you will not be able to focus over a long period of time, and as a result, there will be mistakes and potential risks for accidents. When we have the first year of a survey on the earnings and working hours of workers, we see that now the median number of hours has risen from 45 hours to 49 hours. Hong Kong economic development has been blooming, but the working hours of our workers has been getting longer. Is it because they enjoy working? No, it's because they earn so little that they have to work longer in order to make ends meet. So you have to think about the safety of our workers and employees and also their mental health. You have to legislate to improve the work environment and safety of our employees. Mr. Poon has pointed out a number of major problems. The month before last, I and the CIC held a press conference on a case in which a worker was drowned in the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge project. However, this motion originally was as scheduled in July 9, and my press conference was before that. I would have added more words to it. That is to afford more protection to people working on water. Currently, as long as life-saving facilities are provided, that suffices. What are these life-saving facilities? It can be a life jacket or just a lifeline. But what constitutes sufficient life-saving facilities? There is no mention. And what if the worker doesn't wear it, doesn't say anything about it, then a contravention will attract a fine of $50,000. But I don't think that is sufficient, because there are a lot of government projects that are working over water. Yes, today, the advanced study of an artificial island has been shelved. But for future projects, whether it is the third runway or the incinerator of the Stonecutters Island or the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge, there will be projects working over water. I hope that there will be legislative amendment to afford a higher level of protection to our workers. I mentioned about the $50,000 fine. Yes, that is stated in the law, but no one knows whether it will be the actual penalty dished out. On the 18th of November, well, it so happened that the government announced the latest situation about labor safety in Hong Kong. And on that day, in Hong Shui Kiu, there is a construction worker who died because the employer did not provide sufficient protection. And there is also another case, and the penalty was just $38,000. And $38,000 and $20,000. So we're talking about two lives and $58,000. Well, yes, there is a ceiling of the fine, but should it be taken away? And should there also be a floor of the penalty in order to urge employers to put in place sufficient safety facilities? I mentioned a case when a worker was crushed to death. And there are lots of projects or workplace. The machinery has aged, and a lot of workers lost their lives as a result. There are a lot of such cases in the first half of 14th, and in 2014 and in February there was one fatality, and there was in July another one when another worker was crushed. In May, the crane. It was involved, and in June there is another one involving heavy machinery. They all end in deaths. Well, the year before we were talking about electrocution, and then we talk about machinery, and in summer it's about drowning. So, Secretary, are you concerned about occupational safety? Apart from training more workers, what have you done in relation to safety? And the CIC suggests that when it comes to these major works, should the contractors be required to retire the retire machineries that has reached their useful life, their service lifespan? There are 6 points in my amendment, but in the main part, I mentioned professional drivers. In my preamble, I mentioned about those working in the logistics sector and drivers. When something happened to them, our hearts sank because there is no clear employer-employee relationship. So when something happens, they are not covered by employees' compensation. But what about third-party insurance? But in the end, even if you can get something, you don't know how much you get, and you may not be able to pin someone down. And you know that, well, when it comes to employees' insurance, well, there is just a basic coverage. But our professional drivers face high risk, and there is no protection. According to the Transport Department, in the past 5 years, drivers of commercial vehicles, there are over 100 cases ending in fatalities. That means in the past 5 years, about 100 professional drivers die. Do they get any protection? No, unless you are working for a GMB or franchise bus company. So we ask the administration to set up a central occupational insurance compensation fund so that people who are not covered by employees' compensation insurance can turn to this fund and get a basic protection. Well, you may say that there are so many different trades. Then you can at least start with professional drivers or well, under the current accident schemes, you can put this on top of that. In this way, our society will be more harmonious.
Mr. Chan Kin-por, thank you, President. The number of industrial accidents and fatal accidents has been increasing, and the first half of this year, 5,000 odd. Overall, there has been a decrease in the number of accidents, but then as many more infrastructure projects and coming on stream, more construction workers are set to join the trade, and there will be more accidents, we expect. We can't prevent 100% all accidents, and I think we are obliged to help workers rehabilitate. I would like to introduce an insurance program introduced by the Federation of Hong Kong Insurance. Now, if we can help injured workers rehabilitate, we can help the workers get back to normal life as soon as they can. We've not been doing enough on that front in the medical healthcare sector. The workers are just asked to take painkillers, and then they would visit a specialist, and then one specialist after another, well, they are just like being balls being kicked around, and there is no central coordination, and nobody will be following up on the work after rehabilitation. Under the existing regime, the injured workers are being put in a helpless position. The injured workers are mainly orthopedic patients, and if they're not treated properly, say, if there is no rehabilitation program for them, the workers will be losing the golden period for rehabilitation, and they will not be able to get back to their normal life. And the workers may need more time to get rehabilitated, and that may result also in handicap. So the Federation of Hong Kong Insurers has sponsored the CUHK Orthopedic Department to conduct a study and a research. Now, for this program, it focuses on the orthopedics specialty. Now, orthopedists are very familiar with treatment plans in relation to orthopedics specialty. So the orthopedic doctors should be the central coordinators and intervene at an early stage so that the different specialties can be pulled together to come up with a good rehabilitation plan. The workflow is this: referral of cases. Now, if workers suffer from lower limb diseases, then they can be referred. And then they will be taken to MRI, and then the orthopedics doctors will draw up a rehabilitation scheme for them, pulling in other specialists as well. And then fourth, there will be a rehabilitation scheme, including PT and OT. And then fifthly, there will be the insurers involved. The program has achieved good results, according to information provided by the university. Well, from 2011 up to June this year, 138 patients were treated, and the injured workers can go back to their work earlier, and on average, after 7.6 months, they can get back to work. Compared to those not on the program, the period is 13.7 months, and the results are very encouraging. Actually, the injured workers can cut down on the rehabilitation time period by half if provided with the right conditions. The rehabilitation program needs assistance from all sides, including the employers. And the employer's role is very important. Now, at the present system, there is no way for the employees to communicate with the employers on rehabilitation. So the case managers can come in at this point, and the case managers can help employees and injured workers get rehabilitated as soon as possible and then go back to work soonest. And also the employers can also suffer less economic loss as workers can go back to work earlier. So this is a win-win situation for all. According to the university, this is just a trial program and they need further study to come up with more comprehensive results. But then the model of the scheme enables the injured workers to get rehabilitated soon. And this is can serve as a good reference for injured workers. And I think we can use this program to promote further development of rehabilitation of injured workers. And I hope that at the end of the day, we will be able to set up a rehabilitation center for injured workers. I'm moving this amendment because we now lack rehabilitation policy for injured workers, and the workers are not getting rehabilitated satisfactorily. So this pilot scheme can benefit employers and employees alike. And this model has worked well in overseas jurisdictions. So I hope that the community can study this scheme further to benefit all. I would like to mention about Mr. Tang Ka-piu's motion. He suggested setting up the Central Occupational Insurance Compensation Fund. Now, there have been many frauds related to labor insurance, and the insurance sector has been suffering losses as a result. Now, if the government is to run worker insurance, then the government will be taking on a very heavy burden. And now, even for the private insurance sector, they are suffering losses, not to mention having the government run the scheme. And ultimately, the public money will be used to make up for such losses. So I object to Mr. Tang Ka-piu's motion, so I speak.
Secretary for Labour and Welfare, thank you. I would like to first of all thank Mr. Poon Siu-ping
for moving this motion on ensuring occupational safety. I would also like to thank Mr. Tang Ka-piu and Mr. Chung-kai for moving amendments to the motion. And I think this is a very good opportunity for me to tell members about our occupational safety and health policies, and also our employee compensation policies. Our occupational safety and health legislation stipulates that employers and employees must comply with occupational safety and health standards. Employers must provide safe workplaces and also installations and work systems for the employees, and must provide employees with the necessary guidance, information, training, and supervision. Employers also have to assess the risks in the workplaces and put in place safety measures. If it is discovered that employers have breached safety regulations, the Labor Department will take prosecution action and will also issue improvement notices or suspension notices. The administration is very concerned about occupational safety and health in Hong Kong. In the first half of 2014, the number of industrial accidents was 5,463, down 3.6% when compared with the figure 5,669 in 2013. And the accident rate for every 1,000 workers dropped from 18.8 to 18, a drop of 4.5%. But then concerning fatal accidents in the construction industry, in the first half of 2014, the number was 1,533. And up 6.5% when compared with 1,439 in 2013, or during the same period in 2013. Major infrastructural projects have commenced, and we have seen a lot of maintenance works for old buildings. So in the coming few years, the construction industry will continue to flourish. We have more and more employees joining the construction industry, and the number of construction workers has increased from 50,000 odd in 2009 to over 80,000 in the first half of 2014. And as a result, we face challenges concerning occupational safety and health in the construction sector. As at the middle of November this year, there were 25 fatal industrial accidents this year, and then 20 of them occurred in construction sites. The Labour Department is very concerned, and also there are large numbers of industrial accidents in the catering industry. And then concerning handling of containers, in the first half of 2014, there were 3 fatal accidents. The Labour Department will step up enforcement and also training and also public education and publicity. Our employees' compensation legislation lists 52 protected occupational diseases. In fact, the Labour Department will continue to make reference to the criteria adopted by the ILO. And when necessary, we will update the schedule in the ECO. Even if the diseases are not in the schedule, so long as employees can provide proof that they sustained injuries during accidents at work, they could claim compensation. And also, employers have to, under the law, report industrial accidents within a statutory period. And if or in the case of non-reporting or late reporting without reasonable excuse, or if false or misleading information is provided to the Labour Department, then employers commit an offence, and if they are convicted, they may be fined a maximum of $50,000. The government is extremely concerned about protection for employees in high-risk industries. And in order to help these employers take out labour insurance, there is the Employees' Compensation Insurance Residual Scheme. And also, the hospital authority also provides integrated rehabilitation service. So we will continue to review the situation, taking into account economic development in society. I will give more comments after I have heard members' views.
This is Shin Chung-kai. On behalf of the Democratic Party, I speak to support Mr. Poon Siu-ping and Mr. Chan Kin-por's motion and amended motion. We see that in the past decade, for deaths has decreased from 40,000 odd to 30,000 odd. And when it comes to industrial accidents, it has dropped from about 30% to about 15,000 cases. Although these figures will not make us complacent, because there are three sectors: the construction sector, transportation sector, and according to the government table, catering and accommodation sector that have seen most industrial accidents. The number of these three sectors account for about 80% of the industrial accidents. When it comes to risk management, one of the amendments of Mr. Tang Ka-piu is to set up a central occupational insurance compensation fund. This is a meaningful point, and a meaningful motion as well. I remember that in 2003, there was already some one motion like this, and before that, there were similar motions. So we've been talking about this for over two decades. And in the past two decades, it seems that the administration has done nothing. So should the secretary seriously consider the more high-risk sectors and start with them? Mr. Chan Kin-por talked about employees' insurance, which covers all trades and sectors. I understand that as an employer, I have to take these insurance. It targets general workers. But for the three sectors, the first is construction. The one with the most accidents is catering, to be followed by drivers. But for the amount, the highest is construction. There are levies. The levies are used for training. But can we charge levies to give additional compensation to construction workers? Well, I mean those who suffered from injuries or death. Of course, they are covered by employees' insurance. I'm not going to talk about list out all the accidents mentioned by Mr. Poon and Mr. Tang. I've seen many of these cases in the past year or so, and I visited some of these victims in the hospitals, and it really makes you sad. And I asked the families what I could do for them, and I was dumbstruck when they said, "Can you give me back my husband?" Or, of course, prevention is always better than cure. And apart from prevention, there should be something more to to give them compensation. Mr. Tang's proposal of a central occupational insurance compensation fund, or compensation funds for employees by industry. If you look at the figures, and if you cover them by industry, it seems that you are asking one industry to subsidize another, because there are certain industries that are relatively lower risk. So we should start with the higher risk ones. And from the perspective of risk management, enhance protection. Maybe use something like compensation funds for employees by industry. And if you use the idea of levies, it's used for training. Maybe you can juggle the levies a bit and use some for employees' compensation. You have to start with work in this direction to give better protection to employees, And Mr. Poon mentions about more and more government projects, and it's worrying. Secretary, you admit that, the first half of this year, the number of accidents is higher than that of same period last year. You should do something more. Well, the use of the levy, expand its use to give better protection to employees. Of course, you have to go back to the relevant industry advisory council. If it starts with all the different industries and trades, then we will take more than a decade, and we don't know whether they will be fruitful. And in 2003, there was a similar motion debate, and before that, there was another motion debate. I don't want to repeat it in 10 years' time. So can you at least start with the three sectors that I mentioned? The three sectors I mentioned covers 80% of the industrial accidents. If you start with these three trades and use the idea of employees' compensation fund, then you would have covered 80% of the industrial accidents. This is a risk-based management, and in a way, it would enhance occupational safety awareness in these sectors. It will be a targeted measure. You don't have to cover all industries and trades. Maybe the secretary will have a better idea. And this is anyway my proposal. I ask the secretary and the labor sector to consider it. I speak to support the original motion and all the amendments. Mr. Wong Kwok-hing, I would like to use my 7 minutes to speak for all professional drivers in Hong Kong. I will supplement point number 6 of Mr. Chung Ka-piu, that is to ask for the administration to consider to conduct studies and to come up with a timetable and roadmap for Central Occupational Insurance Compensation Fund for professional drivers. I have with me some statistics from the Census and Statistics Department. Let's look at the professional drivers. Fatality, serious injury, and minor injury of professional drivers. We're talking about a high number. For 2012, for taxis, PLBs, light vehicles, and medium-sized vehicles, we're talking about 9,049 such cases, which is out of the 21,175 of all the vehicles, 41.6%. Let's look at 2013. For these mechanized vehicles, the number of accidents stand at 21,833, and of the five types of vehicles, the drivers account for 9,314 cases, which is 42.7% of the total. And you can see that the percentage has increased. Every year, there are close to 10,000 professional drivers that are not covered by employees' compensation. Why? Because they are self-employed. And because they are self-employed, the administration has been neglecting them. I have with me another document. It's a secretary for labor and welfare. It's not from the secretary himself. Is one of his subordinates. Is an answer dated the 13th of December 2012 to the manpower panel. In the last paragraph, it says that you do not have the statistics for self-employed drivers, that is those that I mentioned. You have not done any studies. You treat them as if they don't exist. These so-called self-employed professional drivers, when they are involved in an accident, injured, or even died, if they want to get some kind of compensation, they can only get something from the traffic accident and injury fund. But they will encounter three obstacles. First, application time. The shortest time it takes is 3 months, and it can be as long as 6. The second obstacle is that the amount is small. They can't work, they have to seek treatment, and they have to meet household expenses because they are the breadwinner in the household. And if they say trip during work, then they would be told that it's nothing to do with a traffic accident. It may be because you sprained your ankle, you tripped, or you suffered from a heat stroke. So you will be penniless because you get nothing. I think the administration should attach importance to it. But what we see now is that for professional drivers, they are excluded from the employees' compensation ordinance because they are treated as self-employed. And the OSHO, the Occupational Safety and Health Ordinance, does not include professional drivers. So I do think that Mr. Tang's amendment is indeed very meaningful. In the transport panel, I have long ago asked to include it in an agenda item. It dragged on till this legislative term, and then the transport and housing secretary told me that it's not under his purview, and it's something under the purview of the welfare panel. So they just passed the buck. Well, I just gave you the figures, the letter on the 13th of December 2012, which said that there was no statistics and no information. In short, nothing to do with him. So I do think that whether it is occupational safety or employees' compensation for professional drivers, they should not and cannot be neglected. So Mr. Tang proposes a central employees' compensation fund or a compensation fund by industry. I do think it has merits. And it's forward-looking for other industries. Of course, they should be covered, but there will be difficulties. Can we at least start with professional drivers? So I asked Mr. Chung, in your concluding remark, speak on this. Let professional drivers of Hong Kong hear from you whether there will be an active role played by the administration.
Dr. Wai-kwok, Acting President. Last year, Mr. Poon Siu-ping also moved a similar motion. And that this motion this year, he is asking the government to comprehensively review the policies on Hong Kong employees' occupational safety and health. And I'm sure that members from different political factions will support that. And he is suggesting that there should be a dedicated committee for dealing with the matter. But I and my colleagues in BPA has reservations on this. Well, there is already the OSHC, which was set up in 1988 based on the OSHC ordinance. and it conducts surveys and policy studies, education and training, and it promotes and provides consultancy services. It strives to enhance safety at various industries. They have 7 subcommittees and 2 advisory committees to provide expert advice, and also 10 specific industry committees have been set up, include covering construction, catering, logistics, automobile repair, and professional services and clerical work sectors, so that they would be targeting or drawing up specific messages for these sectors. There are 90 members representing employers, employees, and the academia. I think the OSHC is a representative, and there is no need to develop or set up a dedicated committee, or there will be duplication of duties. While looking at the statistics, the present the safety measures have room to be improved. Now, the construction industry is a typical example. In the past 10 years, the number of accidents has decreased by 15.7%, and accident rate gone down by 13.5%. But then the fatal accidents and work injuries are still top on the list. In 2013, 20 people died in the construction industry compared to 19 in the past, so a rise of 13.4%. In the first half of this year, there were 15 fatal industrial accidents, and 12 of them are in the construction industry, making up 80% of all, and that is a 3 times increase over the past year. Now, last year, there was an industrial accident causing one fatality and 4 injuries at the construction site of the Hong Kong Zhuhao and Macau Bridge. So we should not be taking these statistics lightly. I think we should work in concerted efforts, so we should have zero tolerance for accidents, and we should adopt a multi-pronged approach to launch different measures to enhance occupational safety at construction works sites. First, you must advance with the times, improve on existing legislation and measures, including revising the Employing Ordinance, OSHC, O, and also UIFO, etc. Well, we should also revise the Construction Workers Registration Ordinance that was first enacted in 2004, and the provisions are implemented in phases. The first phase prohibition took effect in September 2007, prohibiting unregistered workers working in the construction sites. For the remaining prohibition provisions, in April this year, the government has submitted the amendment legislation to the legislature, and we set up a bills committee to look at to scrutinize the bill, and I was a chair. And based on this bill, then a worker can register for his specific skills, and then there is also a letter for the construction to advance, and workers can also register as a master worker if he has got all the skills in that particular trade. We would also be trying to enhance the skills of the workers, and I think the bill helps in improving the skills of the construction workers. Second, the government should step up its support to raise awareness, safety awareness of workers. For example, there should be more on-the-job training for workers, and workers should be encouraged to take part in courses organized by OSHC and CIC. And starting from 2012, the CIC has launched PFSS, and the contractors must clearly state the amount that they are going to spend on safety in the construction site in their tenders. And if they perform well, then the amount will be reimbursed to them. And so that would help encourage contractors to attach importance to work safety. We should also tackle the root of the problem, and we must tackle the problem of shortage of construction workers. The Construction Industry Association's surveys shows that there has been consistently a shortage of 15% of construction workers and 10,000 workers. So this poses a great challenge to the sector. So it has been difficult for the masters to help and train up the newcomers. And the workers have been working long hours, so the workers' safety is jeopardized. And I think the government should tackle this problem. I would also like to point out that the construction, the problems of the construction industry stems partly from the political stalemate, because members are engaging in filibustering, and then there has been delay in the construction works because of filibustering at the PWSC and the FC. So I hope that our electrical operations can restore to normal, and then we can deal with matters and issues in the normal way. And I'm against filibustering, so I speak, Acting President. Dr. An Zhang. Thank you, Acting President. Today, we are discussing the issue of ensuring occupational safety. When we talk about occupational safety, we would naturally think about the major incidents, and that actually that incident happened within a one government department, and in this incident many firemen were injured because of the explosion of the gas. One was in critical condition, another was in serious condition. I think the government is reviewing the situation, so we can see that it's important that the employer abides by the policy strictly. The employees also should also pay attention to their own safety when they work. In 2013, the number of industrial accidents, there were some 38,000. 188 people passed away as a result. So we see that we must attach a lot of importance to this problem. Well, the injury or death of one employee will have an impact on the entire family. And many stories behind these injuries are really saddening. Now, I will discuss several points. First, employers. How can they build a safe work environment? And also, for the employees, they should cultivate good working habits to ensure their own safety. It's just right that they do so. Now, in recent years, many more young people are joining special sectors like the construction industry. And well, there have been advertisements saying that newcomers, when they have worked for several months, can really get a good salary. So before they join the industry, they should get good training on safety. As for the safe work environment, well, as we all know, accidents happen most in the catering industry, especially in kitchens. Well, the kitchen may not be very spacious. There is exhaust fume, and air ventilation is not good. And also the floors may be very slippery and wet. And even if you wear anti-slippery shoes and wear protective gloves and so on. Even if you are, have put on all these protective gears, and accidents still happen. And also, a lot of the workers in the industry have to stand for a long period while they are working. So they may suffer from back pain and so on and so forth. Well, you may fall or slip and your hands may be cut. Well, these are the problems that we are seeing frequently. And you can get compensation from the employer and you can take rest. But then there is another type of industrial accident which has to do with long-standing problems. Well, the problems or the symptoms only surface when you have retired. Well, and I'm talking about people who have to use computers to work. They have to work in front of the computers for a long time. It seems that there are no symptoms. But then if they are not having the right posture and in working in front of the computers, and after a long time, and when the workers age, there may be problems with the necks and the backbones. And the employers may not be able to help you. All they can do, perhaps, is to give you a set of guidelines. And I think it's the responsibility of the employees to make sure that they are well protected and they should take care of themselves. And also, a lot of young people join the construction industry. And some young people have joined the industry for a short time, and then accidents happen to them. Well, there are cases where the accidents happen on the first day, and they die on the first day of work. What happened? Is it the case that the companies have not trained them up properly in terms of safety, or is it that they are just being careless? Now, from this semester onwards, the government will be providing a subsidy in the tune of one month's salary of teacher, and this teacher can help with the life planning of the students. I hope that this teacher can also instill safety awareness in terms of work on the students. So occupational safety is something that we should pay a lot of attention to, and the employers and employees should join hands to improve the situation. Towards Mr. Poon Siu-ping's original motion and the amendment moved by Mr. Tang Ka-piu, we agree to those, and we think that will help improve occupational safety, and we urge the government to review comprehensively the policies on occupational safety. We support DAB supports the motion moved by Poon Siu-ping and amendment moved by Tang Ka-piu.
Mr. Chung Kwok-pan, thank you, President. Ensuring occupational safety is, of course, important, and I don't think anyone would disagree to this objective. One industrial accident is too many, in my view. If on the part of employers, if a lot of employees are injured at work, then employers also suffer. And then, you know, employers need to take out employee or labor insurance. And according to employers in the logistics industry, they have difficulties taking out insurance for their employees. This is because insurance companies are of the view that the accident rate in the logistics industry is high. And so insurance companies either refuse do the business, so to speak, or they charge very high premium. And so it benefits the employers if the occupational safety situation among the employees is sound. So in fact, employers are also concerned about occupational safety. The original motion proposes that a dedicated committee be established to review the policies on Hong Kong's employees' occupational safety and health. Now, the Liberal Party has some reservations. In fact, there is the OSHC under the Labour Department. And seven committees and also some working groups are there to provide advice on occupational safety. And then there are occupational health and safety committees for the different trades. And these committees do try to hammer home the occupational safety and health messages to the employees in the respective industries or trades. And so we have reservations as to whether we need another dedicated committee to ensure employees' occupational safety and health. Public education and publicity are important. We have seen some improvement to the situation because of these public education and publicity efforts. According to the Labour Department, in 2013, a number of injuries and deaths went down by 4.7% when compared with the figure in 2012. And then concerning the accident rate per 1,000 employees, it dropped from 14.7% to 13.2%. And in the construction sector, as members are aware, we've seen more construction works. In 2013, the total amount concerning the works in 2013 doubled that in 2006. But then in 2006, the accident rate was 13.2%, but that dropped to 7.3% in 2013. So you can see in this table that this is the situation in 2006 and this is the situation in 2013. So although we've seen more works projects in Hong Kong, the accident rate has gone down. And in the first half of 2014, in the logistics industry, industry accidents associated with the handling of containers went down by 15% when compared with the figure for the corresponding period in 2013. And then transport, godowning, the accident rate also went down by 20%. So we can see that, in fact, the occupational safety and health situation has improved. Insurance companies increase the premium because the accident rate in a particular industry is high and the amount of claims is high. Some are of the view that there are people who are abusing the employees' compensation system. In fact, some employers have hired private detectives to probe into whether the employees have tried to cheat their employers or the insurance companies. So we must not allow unscrupulous elements to try to obtain employee compensation and protection by deception. But of course, employers must provide employees with adequate training and equipment. Employers must do their best to protect the occupational safety of their staff. I want to say that professional drivers work very long hours every day and they are not in very good health. Most of the professional drivers are over 50 years old. And given their age, it is just natural that their physical conditions are not very good. And so we don't want professional workers to professional drivers rather to have to work long hours. So with regard to non-franchise buses, cross-border buses, now at the moment there is a shortage of drivers. The government is trying to encourage more people to join the trade, or there should be importation of labor to solve the labor shortage problem. Mr. Kwok Wai-keung, thank you. In fact, both employees do attach a lot of importance to occupational safety and health. I want to say that I support Mr. Poon Siu-ping's motion on ensuring occupational safety. In fact, last year we had a debate on a similar motion, and many members who spoke expressed concerns about the so-called fake self-employment situation. 1 year has lapsed, but we haven't seen action taken by the administration to deal with the problem of fake self-employment. And we haven't seen the administration stepping up its efforts to promote occupational safety in the construction industry, in the catering industry. Industrial accident rate is still very high, and employers find it difficult to take out insurance for their employees. First of all, I want to talk about fake self-employment. There are many unscrupulous employers who want to save costs and who want to evade their responsibility to provide employee benefits and protection. So they force their staff to be self-employed persons. But in fact, these are in fact employees. We see such a situation in a number of industries, for example, the transport industry and the catering industry. But then this problem hasn't gone away because of a lack of government action. So employers do not need to take out insurance for these employees. And when these employees get injured, they do not get employee protection, and they have to shoulder the very high medical costs. And then secondly, I want to talk about the problem in many industries. It's difficult to take out insurance for the employees, and the premium is very high. In the cleansing, transport, catering, recycling, and construction industries, the employee compensation policy premium is very high, and very often insurance companies refuse provide the policies. In fact, the premium per year can be up to $100,000 or more for some industries. And then for those who have to do high-rise work, and if the employer wants to take out life insurance for the staff, then about one-third of the project costs may go to insurance. In 2007, the Federation of Insurers launched a residual scheme to cover 22 high-risk industries. But then the premium is still high. For example, scaffolding. In 2012, the premium went up by 15% when compared with the premium in 2010. So according to the authority, till the 31st of March 2013, 219 applications were received. 39 were taken up by individual scheme members. 153 were taken up by the residual scheme, and the others were still outstanding. The residual scheme doesn't cover the catering industry and other services industries. And as a result, for some Chinese restaurants, the premium increased from hundreds of thousands of dollars to over $1 million. And so concerning employees' insurance provided by the market, there is not enough protection. Insurance companies can increase the premium whenever it likes. But then the administration keeps referring to the relevant legislation. It says that it can't interfere with the level of premium charged by insurance companies. And as a result, insurance companies will only choose policies that can bring them profit. So in some sectors, it's difficult to take out employees' compensation insurance. For the transport sector, the premium is 10 times, in the catering industry, 6 times. And as a result, employers force their employees to become the so-called self-employed persons. And there are some of these self-employed persons who take up high-risk jobs without getting any protection. So how much of the money really goes into the high-risk pool? And then for the construction and the internal decorations industry, I understand that there is a scheme to provide training for small and medium-sized contractors and to subsidize them in procuring equipment for the staff. And also, there is up to 50% of the premium subsidy for scaffolding operators. But then there were only about a dozen applications. So we are of the view that there should be a central occupational insurance authority so that things can be centralized, and so that administrative costs for employee compensation insurance can be simplified and streamlined. And also rehabilitation services and subsidies can be provided to the affected employees. Thank you.
Mr. Tony Jay. Mr. President, according to the statistics that are provided by the administration, for the first half of this year, there are 17,000 industrial accidents. 102 of them involved deaths. And when it comes to industrial accidents, it accounts for one-third of the total number of accidents, 5,400 of them, 16 of them are fatal ones. Compared to the first half of 2013, there is been an increase by 200%. The administration explained that because in the first quarter there was a major industrial accident resulting in a significant increase in fatality cases. But we don't see any sign that it will drop. At the end of October this year, there are 19 cases resulting in fatality. 7 more, 6 of them involves people working from height. And there are 3 for electrocution and 3 other cases. And on average, there are 2 cases every month involving fatalities. The situation is very serious. I think our contractors, the administration, and construction workers should deal with this seriously and aim at driving down the number of cases so that it will end, so that it will reach 0 in the end. From these figures, we see that the construction sector is a high-risk industry. And in light of this, administration has, through multi-pong approach, enhanced safety, occupational safety, including publicity, education, training, enforcement and legislation. In this way, the administration would like hope to control the risk factor. And when it comes to trade associations, labor unions, in administration, relevant sectors, well, they all work together aiming at improving the occupational safety level in Hong Kong. We have to effectively prevent the occurrence of accidents. But I noticed that when it comes to falling from height in the construction sector, ending in deaths, has been increasing. In 2011, there were 2, and in 2013, there were 14. 7 of them involved renovation and decoration. This is indeed worrying. In recent years, the administration has launched the MBIS, MWIS, the mandatory building or window inspection scheme, so there are more and more of these works available. But in the construction sector, there is a generation gap. The average age of construction workers is quite high, so it makes people worry that it will put pressure on construction workers because they want to finish their work to meet the demand and at the expense of occupational safety awareness, and we need the administration and the relevant parties to deal with it more actively. I know that the Building Services Department, in the implementation of the MBIS, made arrangements, some new arrangements, to first deal with old buildings with an urgent need for repair, so that the scheme will be effectively implemented, and at the same time, resources will be better used. I support these arrangements. And in recent years, there are a lot of private buildings. They use new designs that are unconventional. Say, for example, French window curtain wall, Louvre windows. Well, they are very popular with buyers. But at the same time, for workers working outside the building, there may be an impact. There are some newly built buildings. The maintenance path outside is too narrow, so it's impossible for workers to properly conduct their work outside the building. And the design of some buildings pose a lot of unnecessary restrictions on scaffolding. And workers are faced with higher risk when they are doing their job. And as a result, there is a higher risk of accidents. And recently, I talked about this in an interview with the RTHK. I think that when developers are trying to sell the flats, of course, they would like to sell them for as something beautiful and aesthetic, but it should not be done at the expense of employees and construction workers. There are a lot of problems with maintenance and repair. I suggested that the administration can deal with this in two ways. First, through legislation to require developers to submit at the time of making proposals feasible maintenance and repair plans, and two, to require developers or architects at the designing stage make effective proposals and proposals that meet certain standards when they submit plans for construction, in order to get the government's approval of the plans and to get more floor area for construction. And in this way, they are encouraged to give more consideration to ensuring occupational safety. Inspection by the Labour Department is also an effective way to keep number of accidents down. But I would like the administration to avoid impeding progress of work, because this will slow down the supply of residential flats. And of course, I would like to see construction workers' safety awareness enhanced, so that we will all work together to improve our occupational safety level. I so submit. Does any other member wish to speak, Mr. Leung Yiu-chung? Today, Mr. Poon Siu-ping move this motion, which is important. The figures mostly suggest that there is an improvement when it comes to industrial safety. And in the recent manpower panel that we talk about occupational safety, we were told that there has been a lot of improvement. The situation is different. And when it comes to fatalities and injuries, there has been remarkable improvement. And in recent years, indeed, when it comes to occupational diseases and industrial accidents, we see the situation getting better. I'm not going to repeat what other members have said. However, there is one point that I have touched on in the manpower panel. When it comes to industrial accidents with injuries or fatality, even one case is too many. I am sure that the Secretary agrees with me when we say that, because when there is an industrial accident, it's not only the worker who suffer. More likely than not, the family will be affected as well. So it's more serious than you think. And if, unfortunately, it ends in death, it will be unacceptable, because it will affect the entire family financially, and it will hurt them by taking someone they love away. And I'm sure that members will agree with me that one case is too many. And you may recall something that is often said. And well, we wish that everyone will go to work happily and come home safely. It's a slogan that has not really left us. And this is common ground for us. But how do we bring down the figure? We don't want it to stand high, just like what Mr. Poon said. We want it to keep dwindling. When you look at the development of construction sector compared to and that of other sectors, I am very worried, because I am worried that it will go up instead of down. Why do I say that? Because, first of all, as some members have said, there are more and more infrastructure projects. As a result, we need a lot of workers. But as you say that, well, because of the situation in this sector, it's difficult for them to attract new blood. So there is manpower a shortage. And what do our contractors do? It's just like what other members said, by lengthening the working hours. And that is a problem. Because as I said in the panel, that by lengthening the working hours, it will lengthen the strenuous work they are faced with. And they are exposed to the elements. And this will in turn pose a mental stress on them. If they are subject to long working hours, it's difficult for them to escape from an accident. So we've been talking about standard working hours. Secretary, can it be dealt with as soon as possible? Don't drag your feet. Don't just talk about study by the committee. Don't study whether it should be implemented, because it's completely different from what we have in mind. We want you to study on how to implement it. I find it really disappointing. And apart from standard working hours, there is another issue that is seemingly unrelated: retirement. A lot of workers are worried about their retirement. They engage in manual work, and when they are getting on, then their strength will fail them, and they will have to stop work. Who will support them? How can they save enough to support them in their retirement years? They have to pay for all sorts of expenses every year. Yes, their wages have increased, but still, they have to pay a lot of expenses. Can they save put enough away to support their retirement? Not really. So they need some kind of a retirement protection, if they have retirement protection, then they don't have to live worrying about what will happen later. And then they don't have to work the fingers to the bones. And in this way, this will allay their mental stress and the physical stress, and in turn, this will reduce the number of industrial accidents. And in the catering sector, we see a lot of industrial accidents because of the work environment is less than desirable. If you're in the kitchen, maybe it's slippery and all the utensils are packed together. And I now hear that there is a shortage of dishwashers. They have to stand up to wash dishes. So you can imagine how what toll it takes on your body. And they will come home aching all over. And we're talking about a long time, so they will have a lot of health problems when they get old. It seems that you have failed to take into account their working hours and the work environment, and they are left to their own devices, and as a result, there are lots of problems surfacing. And there is responsibility on the part of the government to deal with all these. We don't just look at the number of cases and figures, because there are some that are hidden. So, Secretary, please, do more. Address the long working hours and the retirement protection, because these will directly or indirectly bring down the number of industrial accidents or help with their occupational diseases. Say, for example, it will help them with their work so that they'll be less prone to accidents. And these are just my suggestions. Thank you.
Does any other member wish to speak? Honorary Poon Siu-ping, you may now speak on the two amendments.
Mr. President, I'd like to thank the 10 members who have spoken on the motion, and they're concerned about occupational safety of workers in Hong Kong. I don't have any objection to the amendments moved by Tang Ka-piu and Chung Kai. Tang Ka-piu discussed safety of professional work drivers. Labor groups like my group, if HKLU, have also covered safety of professional workers, professional drivers, and also protection for workers in inclement weather, workers working at a high pollution, air pollution level, and during the hot weather. In my motion, these points were not covered, but then these were not mentioned in Tang Ka-piu's amendment either. But in inclement weather, it is very important to protect or safeguard the safety of workers. And I hope that the Secretary can consider these points and follow up duly. As to Mr. Chan Kin-por's motion on rehabilitation management. Starting from 2003, we have been seeing the implementation of the voluntary rehab program, and which some say is not effective. I think that should be reviewed. So I support the suggestion. So again, I would like to thank members for speaking, and I hope that members can support my motion.
Secretary, I thank Mr. Poon Siu-ping for moving this motion, and I would also like to thank Mr. Tang Ka-piu and Mr. Chung Kai-piu for the amendments. And I thank all the members who have spoken. I want to say that, in fact, the administration attaches great importance to occupational safety and health. Mr. Poon Siu-ping, in his original motion, proposes that a dedicated committee be set up to review occupational safety and health and employee compensation matters. Mr. Chung Kai-piu, in his amendment, suggests that the present rehabilitation policies be reviewed. I want to point out that in his election manifesto, the CE proposed that a task force be set up comprising representatives from the employers and the employees at the Labour Department to carry out a study. In fact, an interdepartmental working group has already been set up. The working group or the task force looks at the taking out of employee compensation insurance in detail, and it also carries out in-depth studies with regard to insurance compensation, treatment, and rehabilitation services, so that policy bureaus and departments can take follow-up action. And we will be able to, in the first half of next year, announce the way forward. Under the Labour Advisory Committee, there is the OSH committee comprising representatives from employers, employees, professional bodies, and government representatives. This committee reviews the occupational safety and health standards in Hong Kong, and it also provides advice to the Labour Department on safety codes and so on and so forth. The committee is concerned about the issue of occupational safety and health, especially occupational safety in the construction sector. It helps the government work out suitable policies and initiatives. First of all, I want to talk about the construction industry. Now, in fact, the Occupational Safety and Health Council and the Labour Department have adopted a number of measures. First of all, we have stepped up inspection and monitoring. The Labour Department carries out 50,000 regular inspections. And concerning high-risk procedures, for example, working at height and electrical works, tunneling works, and so on and so forth, we have taken special enforcement action. In the past 2 years, the Labour Department stepped up the inspection of construction sites. Enforcement action was rigorously taken. And in fact, if serious irregularities are detected, prosecution action will be taken and suspension notices are issued. And concerning high-risk jobs, the Labour Department urges the contractors to step up safety measures and safety management systems. The Labour Department will continue to make sure that contractors and site management staff will take into account the safety elements in the design of work processes, in tendering, and in the actual construction works. So the purpose is to effectively deal with the risk problem at source. Secondly, we try to focus on reducing systemic risk. The Labour Department has stepped up the analysis of serious accidents, and targeted inspections and enforcement actions have been taken, and safety seminars have also been held, and safety codes have been drawn up. The Labour Department, in fact, this year organized a number of safety seminars and issued safety warnings to urge contractors, employers, and employees to adopt suitable safety measures. And together with the CIC, the Labour Department has published some new guidelines and safety codes concerning safety on scaffolding. Special enforcement operations have also been mounted by the Labour Department to make sure that the sector will comply with the new safety codes. And then concerning the merit and demerit system for occupational safety, the Labour Department, together with the OSHC, have launched various subsidy and safety certification programs. In June 2012, the for the RMAA, there was the OSH Star Enterprise Safety Accreditation Scheme. And as a result, there were safety audits carried out for small and medium-sized contractors, safety training, and so on and so forth. And then we've also joined hands with the insurance industry concerning how to reduce premium. At the moment, for a skilled worker, the insurance premium per year can be $120,000. But then if there is safety certification, then there can be savings up to $60,000. And then we have also got a scheme to encourage small and medium sized enterprises to purchase mobile working platforms to replace the dangerous A-shaped ladders. As at the end of October, the OSHC has approved 1,470 applications benefiting 16,000 workers. Concerning penalties, the Labor Department provides sufficient information for the courts to refer to, including the serious consequences of the accidents and the trends concerning such offences. And if necessary, we may seek the DOJ's advice concerning seeking a review or an appeal for a court ruling. And then we've stepped up publicity and education as well as training. The Labor Department, together with the OSHC and the construction sector, launched an annual Construction Industry Safety Award Scheme. This is to increase the safety awareness of employers and employees in the construction industry. The Labor Department has also joined hands with trade unions to organize talks on how to prevent accidents. And injured workers as well as their family members have been invited to attend such talks to share their experience with the audience. And then we've also carried out case analysis with regard to cases of work at height, lifting operations, electrocution, and so on and so forth. And the Labor Department will continue to issue occupational safety alerts through mobile phones, reminding the sector that it should pay attention to the adoption of safety and prevention measures to prevent serious accidents. Now let me come to the catering industry. The Labor Department will continue to mount territory-wide activities like the Catering Industry Safety Award Scheme. The OSHC in June last year launched the outstanding OSH restaurant pilot scheme on catering safety accreditation. The purpose is to increase the occupational safety awareness of the employees. And through auditing the enterprises, the OSHC awarded accreditation and certificates and also subsidies for slip-resistant shoes and cut-resistant gloves. And over 800 restaurants have taken part in the scheme. And in fact, the Labor Department has also produced an API on work safety for the catering industry. Now let me come to the handling of cargoes, or rather containers. The Labor Department carries out regular inspections at container terminals, and we take enforcement action where necessary.
We also make provision for the container companies to make improvements regarding meal break, toilet break, and inclement weather situations. We also organize OSH seminars to enhance safety awareness and to make sure that the workers will ensure their own work safety and to prevent musculoskeletal disorders. I must say that the safety behind the wheels would involve many factors like the design and maintenance of vehicles and roads, the driver's driving skills, the safety equipment, as well as the drivers' behaviors. All these are subject to regulation by the legislation. It would be very difficult for the employers to supervise the driving attitude of the drivers behind the wheel. Be that as it may, the relevant legislation also ensures the OSH term of the drivers. The compensation for injuries will be protected by the law. The employers simply cannot evade the statutory responsibilities by switching the status to self-employment, and they have to take out the insurance. All these responsibilities cannot be evaded. When considering the occupational diseases, we will take into account the International Labour Organization's guidelines and also the local situation. Even if the disease is not incorporated into the employment compensation ordinance, as long as the workers can prove that the injuries is sustained at work, they can still seek compensation. There are some musculoskeletal disorder, like tendinitis, that has to do with their job. They have been incorporated into the schedule of the employees' compensation ordinance. As regards varicose veins, the back pain, shoulder pain, and so on, they can be caused by many factors. They can be caused by work. They can also be caused by factors unrelated to work, like the family history, the age profile, the diet, and so on. And they are not in line with the definition of occupational diseases. But the Labour Department will keep this under review on a regular basis. As regards the compensation or protection for work injuries, we are reviewing the situation on a regular basis. Recently, in accordance with the established mechanism, we have reviewed the compensation level for employees' compensation ordinance, pneumoconiosis and mesothelioma compensation ordinance. The increase ranged between 5.73 to 44.44%. This provides reasonable protection for the sufferers. With the support of the Labour Advisory Board, we have already submitted the proposals to the Manpower Panel for discussion on November the 18th. We are grateful to the panel for their support. We anticipate that the amendments will be submitted to the Council in early 2015 for early implementation. The proposal to set up a central employees' compensation fund is a rather complicated issue. As members said, we have had sufficient discussions on this. We have to consider all the implications arising from this proposal. One of the arguments of the proposal is that for high-risk trades, it will be difficult for the employers to take out insurance in the private market. In order to make sure that insurance can be taken out and in order to make sure that protection can be offered, the insurance sector back in May 2007, did launch the Employees' Compensation Insurance Residual Scheme. And the board of the insurance scheme has already activated the function back in August 2011. For those employers who are experiencing difficulties, they will be protected. As of October 2014, the cases undertaken by the residual scheme board numbers 608. Under the compulsory labor insurance scheme, this has been working well, and this is in line with the actual situation in Hong Kong. and it is not the right time for us to make any major changes to it. Mr. Tang Ka-piu, I referred to the filing of work injuries and occupational diseases. I must point out under the employees' compensation ordinance, the employers have the obligation to file the accidents. If they fail to do so without any reasonable excuses, they will be subject to a fine of $50,000. We have the voluntary rehabilitation scheme. Under the arrangement of the insurance companies, they can take advantage of the private rehabilitation service, and this would enable them to be back to their work as soon as possible. And this is going to be a win-win situation for everybody all around. There are 16 insurance companies taking part in this scheme. Since March 2003 through to 2013, we have seen 12,700 cases that they have taken part, and 30% of the cases have to do with the construction trade. This indeed has provided an added protection to the workers. Members also expressed concerns over the marine work. The Marine Department, in accordance with the relevant legislation, requires the responsible employers to provide all the protective gear and clothing, and there has to be life-saving equipment. And under the OSH ordinance, the employers have to assess the potential risks of the workers falling into the sea, and there has to be sturdy railings and life-saving equipment and facilities to be provided. And also the workers have to wear safety or the life-saving vests while at work at sea. The Labour Department also conducts inspection. If there are any irregularities, we will take action accordingly. The CIC has also produced all the relevant materials, and we are organizing a seminar soon to promote safety while working at sea. President, over the past decade or so, with concerted efforts of various parties, we have been achieving steady progress. But recently, we are witnessing an upsurge in construction projects, and we have seen an increase in the number of accidents. With the concerted efforts, we should be able to overcome all the challenges. We will, together with the stakeholders, promote the level of occupational safety and health. President, we are concerned about the protection of workers in the light of the changing situation, and in light of the actual situation, we keep the legislation under review to make sure that the protection offered to the workers will be able to move on with times, having regard to the affordability of the employers. We will keep an open mind in considering all the proposals regarding OSH, and we will monitor the situation and listen to what members have to say and effect improvements in a timely manner. We have to strike a balance between OSH and the actual situation. Thank you.
Mr. Tang Ka-piu, please move your amendment. President, I move that Honorable Poon Siu-ping's motion be amended. I now propose the question to you, and that is that the amendment moved by Tang Ka-piu to Poon Siu-ping's motion be passed. I now put a question to you as stated. With those in favor, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. I think the question is agreed by a majority, respectively, of each of the two groups of members. There's those returned by FCs and those returned by GC through direct elections who are present. I declare the amendment passed. Members have already been informed as Honorable Tang Ka-piu's amendment has been passed. Honorable Chan Kin-por has withdrawn his amendment. Mr. Poon Siu-ping, you may now reply. You have 3 minutes and 33 seconds. Mr. President, I'm grateful to colleagues in the chamber who have spoken.
They have given us very good advice concerning occupational health and safety. I hope the administration will take them on board. I think members are clear about my intention, so I'm not going to use up all my time. And now put the question to you, and that is to the motion moved by Honorable Poon Siu-ping as amended by Honorable Tang Ka-piu be passed. Will those in favor please raise their hands? Those against, please raise their hands. I think the question is agreed by majority, respectively, of each of the two groups of members, that's those returned by FCs and those returned by GC through direct elections who are present. I declare the motion as amended passed. I now adjourn the meeting and we will resume next week.